Rev up your engines!
Ben Tovar says, is engine braking bad for your transmission when going down a long descent? Let's use our brains. Engines and transmissions cost thousands and thousands of dollars to rebuild when they break. Brakes cost practically nothing. You get AutoZone for most cars for 20-something bucks. You can get brake pads and replace them yourself in 50, 60 minutes. So braking is very cheap. Now, of course, you want to be safe. If you're going to Rockies down the mountain, you don't want to keep stepping on the brakes, burn out the brakes, and then maybe get in an accident. Transmissions and engines wear out faster that way, and they cost a lot of money, while brakes are pretty cheap. They don't cost that much money. Anthony Rivera says, back in the day, we used to use liquid wrench to clean out the valves and get the sludge out, and it worked perfectly fine. Another thing was pouring automatic transmission fluid in the carburetor while you rev it up, and that cleaned them out too. You can't do that in any modern cars. And you know why? Because it'll ruin the catalytic converter. Those are oils, they're burning, they will clog up the catalytic converter, they'll ruin the oxygen sensors, and it eventually costs you a fortune to repair the stuff. So don't do it on any modern cars. You got an old clunker, doesn't have a catalytic converter on it, do it to your heart's content. But anything that's got oxygen sensors and catalytic converters, you can't do it because it will eventually ruin them by clogging them up with burnt oil. Case Williams says, I'm looking for a good truck I can use as a daily driver, take it off-roading on the weekends with friends. Down to a Chevy Colorado ZR2 2016 and newer, or a 2013 F-150 SVT Raptor. Okay, go to the Raptor for sure. It's a much better off-road vehicle. I got customers with them. They love them. They play around with them. They put a lot of additions on. If they don't buy the top of the line one, they have added a lot of their own stuff. But even a factory one is pretty well made. The Raptors for going off-road, it's already lifted. It's already got a lot of the Ford heavy-duty differentials and heavy-duty suspension. Definitely get the Ford if you're seriously going to do some off-road fun. It'll outlast the Chevy by far, especially when you go off-road with it. Max Jr. says, Scotty, I got a 2012 Honda Accord. I changed the oil a few months ago, and it's at 40% wear already. And I put less than 2,000 miles. Here's what you have to understand about those oil change systems. They're computer-run systems, and they take many things into effect. How fast you drive, how long you drive, how many hours the average trip is. If you only take short little trips, it's going to tell you to change the oil more often. It's an intelligent system. On the other hand, if you drove 100 miles back and forth to work every day, like the guys I used to know in Houston, then you would change your oil less because you're going at highway speeds all the time and there's less oil dilution and problems at higher speeds. So just go by what it says. When it says it's time to change, change it. Unless it goes wacky and doesn't tell you to change it or tells you to change it 2 weeks later, which would mean the computer system is broken down. Then go back to the old, change the oil every 5,000-6,000 miles or once a year. It's a lot simpler. Buster Wilson said, Scotty, got an 03 Honda Civic, manual transmission. Won't go all the way into first to reverse at standstill. I take my foot off the clutch and back, it'll usually go. All right, simplest thing, that's what? 18-year-old Honda Civic. Replace the clutch master cylinder, clutch slave. They don't cost much at a discount place like AutoZone. You can watch my videos on how to replace clutch master cylinders and slave cylinders. Very easy job. That should fix it. Now, if it doesn't, you're going to have to pull the transmission off and have all the clutch parts, the whole clutch kit replaced, because that would mean that's wearing out. But 9 times out of 10 or 99 times out of 100, it's just the master or the slave cylinder's wearing out, and you can easily replace them yourself. It's a no-brainer job. Mr. Angelus Trex says, Scotty, my dad has an old Honda, and I'm going to learn how to drive. Is it a good idea to swap the old Honda engine to VTEC since the engine doesn't work? Well, here's the problem. You got an old one and you're putting a VTEC engine in, the computer's different, the software's different, the wiring harness is different, the sensors are different. If you can find a Honda mechanic who says, no problem, I've done it before, I know what to do, ask him what he's going to charge and have him do it. But you go buy one from a junkyard and put it in, it's going to run right because everything has to mesh, and the old engine has completely different setups, so it's not something you could do because there's too much different computer software, different sensors, different wiring, and a different computer itself. So if you know a guy, find a guy that can do it, yeah, but if not, don't even try. Go back with the old style one. Love 7 Wisdom 7 says, Scotty, are a 93 and 95 CK Chevy any good for hauling stuff? Well, they are. The old ones were pretty well made. I get people all the time here in Tennessee bringing me those early 90s GMs, and they're still in pretty good shape with the V8 engines. The new ones, not so much. The quality control's been going downhill for decades, but back then, they were solid vehicles. If you can find an old one, hey, buy buy it. Fix it up. The engine's up the wazoo for those things. Soup them up or not soup them up. You can always fix them. I know these people here in Tennessee, they said, I'm keeping this thing forever. If it's not rusted, why not? Just keep fixing it and driving it. As long as they keep selling gasoline, you can keep driving them. Maybe they'll stop, but then here in Tennessee, the moonshiners can make moonshine, and you can run them on alcohol. Wolf, the car enthusiast, says, why are Lexuses so slow? Well, I don't know, man. Hey, Lexuses you've driven, but I've driven slow Lexuses, and I've driven some pretty fast ones. Now, if you're talking about slow in a relative term, that they're slower than a Dodge Challenger or a Cobra Mustang, yeah. Lexus is not a company that makes racing cars, muscle cars. That's not their business. They make luxury cars, and they make luxury sporty cars, but they don't make true sports cars or muscle cars. That's not their business. They're not trying to compete. If Toyota wanted to, they own Lexus. If Toyota wanted to make the fastest car in the world, they could. But what would be the point? You don't make much money making the fastest car in the world because they don't sell that many of them. That's just why Toyota doesn't make the new Toyota Supra. It's just a BMW Roadster made in Austria, and it's called Toyota. Toyota didn't want to do the research and design of making a sports car, so they just bought a BMW and said, just like the Toyota 86 is really the Subaru. It's made in the Subaru factory. They didn't want to design a little sports car, so they just called that a Toyota 86, but it was actually made by Subaru. So Lexuses aren't slow, but they're not a company that's not where they make their money. They make luxury cars people want to drive a really long time, not spend much money on maintenance, have a luxury car that rides well and smooth, and it's certainly fast enough, but they aren't racing cars. And that's why they're not the fastest out there, because they don't need to be, and the company doesn't care about it. That's not where they make their money. Nick Barron says, my 2011 Ford F-150 jerks hard from first to second when I do slow acceleration. All the other gears are good. What can I do? If you've been changing your fluid every 50, 60,000 miles in the transmission, change your filter and fluid. But let's say you haven't and it's got a lot of miles on it. You don't want to change the fluid and filter because it might even get worse. In that case, what I would say would be drop the pan and save the dirty fluid. Change the filter and put the old fluid back in, only instead of 1 quart of the old fluid, put 1 quart of Lucas anti-slip additive and see what happens. And if it still does it, I'd live with it, because it would mean to stop it, you would probably have to rebuild the entire transmission, which would cost thousands of dollars, and most people aren't going to bother if it worked good enough otherwise. Alex G says, Scotty, hi from Luxembourg, Europe. Nice to talk to you. Congrats on what you do. It's awesome. I have a Civic sedan, 2019 1.5 turbo, and have a bit of oil dilution, gets slightly above max. All right. Use the highest quality oil. Use that new GF6 oil. That's made for those that can help oil dilution. Also, probably let your car warm up a little more than normal in the winter so that it doesn't dilute. Realize when your engine's ice cold and you start it up, the way a cold engine starts in cold areas like Europe, they need extra fuel. So the fuel injectors spray extra fuel. You got extra fuel when it's cold. So if you just start it and drive fast, that extra fuel can dilute the oil. If you let it warm up a little, there's only a little bit at idle, and it'll generally work a lot better. Canadian friends of mine do the same thing. They warm up their Hondas a little bit longer in the winter, and they don't have that much of a problem. And of course, do change your oil regularly. Don't listen to any of the nonsense that people tell you with that engine. The engines cost a fortune. They're very well made, very powerful. Change the oil and filter every 5,000 or 6,000 miles with that GF6 oil, and that can really help it out. Stefan Elis Beck says, hey, from Iceland, what do you think of the Skoda Octavia 2016 manual gasoline front wheel drive? Well, they don't sell them in the United States. But I have friends in England, and they've been driving Skodas for decades. They love them. So I'm sure they're decently built vehicles. The English generally are tight with their money. They don't have that much spendable income. So I met a guy outside of London, and he said, this is the 8th one that I've owned in my life, and I love these cars. So in the United States, you'd never buy one. You couldn't get parts for the stupid thing, and no one knows how to fix them. But there, people do know how to work on them. And you're in Iceland. From what I know, it's a pretty small country. You can't drive that many miles, or you run out of land, and you're in the ocean. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.